Hello and welcome to the National Security Conversation. Exactly a year ago, the BJP-led government of India read down Article 370 of the Indian Constitution and divided the then state of Jammu and Kashmir into two union territories. Why did the government of India take this drastic step? What has been the situation in Jammu and Kashmir since the constitutional change? What is the state of politics in Jammu and Kashmir today? More importantly, how accurate is the argument that Article 370 and 35A of the Indian Constitution hindered the economic growth of Jammu and Kashmir? And what lies ahead for Jammu and Kashmir now? To discuss these issues and more, I have with me Dr. Haseeb Drabu, the former finance minister of Jammu and Kashmir. He was earlier the chairman of the Jammu and Kashmir Bank.
Welcome to the National Security Conversation, Dr. Haseeb Drabu. Let me begin with this question about what happened in August 2019. The government of India, led by the Bharatiya Janata Party, read down Article 370, withdrew the special status given to Jammu and Kashmir, divided the state into two union territories, and placed the Jammu and Kashmir Union Territory under a lieutenant governor who reports to the Union Home Ministry. What led to the drastic step that the government of India took in August 2019? What is your reading of the situation?
Well, BJP has been saying for the last 70 years, it is an ideological issue with them. And it starts in Jammu. As soon as the special status was worked out, the agitation starts in Jammu, which was very famously known as the Ek Vidhan, Ek Pradhan, Ek Samvidhan agitation. And if any city can claim to be at par with Nagpur in terms of its ideology, it is Jammu. It had a very strong presence of the RSS and the Praja Parishad at that point. So it started then. What eventually became the BJP comes from there. So it's a, and every single election manifesto that I have read of the BJP has been making this point. So it honestly was there on top of the agenda. Now the what exact thing triggered it is still something that there is no great clarity. At least I don't have that clarity. But I'm not surprised by this this development, because it's an ideological it has been an ideological issue with them, and once they got the kind of mandate that they got, they have kind of put it in place. So the conjectural factors on that particular moment are not really important. So that is one part of this thing. Second, in terms of if you look at 370, the abrogation of 370, I think on August 4, 2019, what existed as 370, it was the greatest fraud perpetuated by the government of India on the people of J&K. Led politically by the Congress Party. Between 54 and 2019, I'll say. There's been a sequence of events which is detailed and long. You're very well aware of it. So August 4, Article 370 was the biggest fraud perpetuated by the government of India or the people of J&K. On August 5th, it was a bigger fraud perpetuated on the people of India. What was there to abrogate? Even as early as 1964, on December 3rd, Gulzarilal Nanda, who was the Home Minister, tells the Parliament that we have emptied Article 370. Whether it stays or not makes no difference. And this is repeated by the Prime Minister in January in the Parliament, saying the process has started, it is over now. 370 has no meaning.
But so that is not how...
What did the BJP abrogate then, really speaking, in terms of effectively? Optics of it, yes, I understand. Politics of it, I understand. Substantively, in terms of the actual things that would have changed, what is it that has happened? Important things have happened post the abrogation of Article 370. which is not getting as much play in the media as it ought to have got. Whether it's in terms of the domicile rights, whether it's in terms of the delimitation, whether it's in terms of, you know, powers that are now given to army to acquire land and so on and so forth, all kinds of stuff. So the real work is happening post of August. But for the optics of it, yes, of course. And I'm seeing it purely from a Kashmir perspective. When you look at the national perspective, it's different. Because there is this whole thing which has been built up that you have reintegrated Kashmir. That was a big kind of, that's how it was packaged and positioned. So I think that's where one should kind of look at.
Right. So you are essentially saying that what happened in August 2019 was essentially driven by BJP's ideology going back a very long time. However, the BJP sold it very differently in August last year. It said that the removal of Article 370 or reading down of it will lead to empowerment of the people of Jammu and Kashmir, will lead to economic development, it will lead to uprooting of terrorism, etc. So they never spoke of ideology at all. They had a completely different set of reasons to justify this.
So, you see, that is how you package and position it. I'm saying so what is the reason for it is fundamentally the fact of their own ideology, which they have been articulating for the last 70 years. It's a commitment which they have been making. By election after election. It's something that the RSS has been suggesting for the last 70 years, I say. So I'm not really saying that, you know, how they packaged it. Of course, that is different. That and that we can debate and discuss whether that was. But that's, of course, not the real reason.
Let's talk about the packaging a bit. 1 year later, this is almost 12 months after the drastic decision was taken in August last year. What has changed on the ground? Violence-wise, development-wise, are people happy about it? What's your sense of what's happening on the ground? What has changed on the ground, if any, at all?
Well, not that I expected any change. As I said, since August 5th, not that I have been back in the state, but of course there is a huge kind of it's a very layered kind of a thing, if you ask me. It, in some ways, the way the package was designed, I must say, was carefully thought through. The fact that you converted it to a union territory. Now, constitutional things apart, I have written about it.
I'll come there in a minute. I know.
But leaving that aside for the moment. In terms of what the constitutional validity of all this is. The fact remains that on ground, with this package of 370, 35A, Union Territory and all that, the overwhelming sense that I get from people in Kashmir, people like myself also, feel very, very humiliated, extremely betrayed by this, not just the fact of what was done, but also how it was done. So there is a whole, both these things are very, very important. I've written about it. I don't agree at all that 370 or a special position in JNK hampered the economic development of JNK. I mean, there's no question about that. And when economic development is talked about, you take any indicator, any development indicator in the world, whether it is literacy, lifespan, whatever, social spending, any indicator, JNK is way much better than many, many states, which include states like Gujarat and Karnataka and Tamil Nadu, which are like good states, right? They are the better performing states, federally speaking. We are better than that in terms of, you know, life expectancy at birth, for instance. Literacy, yes, poverty. Right. All the indicators are much better. So if 370 had been a dampener for development, then this wouldn't have happened.
Let's deal with that issue. Let's look at, there are two issues here. One is about whether or not Article 370 was a hindrance for development in the state. And the other issue of whether or not Kashmir is doing better because of central economic assistance. Now, let's discuss the first one first. Whether Article 370 did play the role of as a roadblock in the economic development of Jammu and Kashmir state, the then state of Jammu and Kashmir.
Absolutely not. I mean, if you look at what was 370 doing, I mean, it was not acting as a barrier. Now this barrier is the is being constructed by the BJP in response to the Congress narrative of a bridge. Article 370 was called as the bridge or the tunnel through which much traffic has passed, as they said in the parliament that time also. So a bridge, how does a bridge become a barrier? I mean, purely in terms of economic development, I can't think of a single reason.
You can't buy land, for instance. People say you can't, an outsider cannot go up, go there and set up industries. And these are real reasons, they would say.
Now, there itself, it has nothing with 370. It refers specifically to Article 35A. It has nothing with 370, buying of land.
Right.
However, 35A draws its origins thing from ordinance in 1927, the state subject notification of Maharaja. Clause 4 of that notification had a provision for giving land for developmental purposes, for industrial purposes, for corporate purposes, and for any other purpose that is deemed good for the state. From 1927, this is a clause. It exists even in the thing 35. Right from 1960 onwards, when industrial policy was first worked out in J&K, from that time onwards, not only land is available, it has been given to corporates, it was available at throwaway prices, and people availed of it also. How was Chinab Textile Mill in J&K? It's a Birla enterprise. Birla. It came to J&K in 1964. How did it do so? I'm sure you have traveled to Srinagar. How was Oberoi's hotel there? How was Indian Taj, Indian hotels there, Taj? How were they there? If land is not available, how were they there? Were they illegally there? So it makes no sense, because there is a provision in the law. And not only that, we have, the government of J&K has given enormous amounts, not only land, the government of J&K gave enormous amounts of subsidies for people to come. There were fiscal concessions. I had worked out while I was finance minister, and I had presented this to the cabinet also, that the amount of money that the state government has given as incentive to industry is more than the total investment that has come. I have never heard of this anywhere else. And I'm not adding up the central incentives of excise exemptions and so on and so forth. I'm just adding the state incentives. If you were to sit down and calculate how much money revenue has the state foregone and how much it has given, it is more than the total investment in J&K. So what are we talking of here?
And there is very little public corporate investment in J&K
and,
from government.
And we are talking of private, when you talk of private investment, you are really talking of post-90s. Till 90s, there was no major public investment happening in India. It was all private investment. It was all public investment, right?
Right.
So we are between 50 and 90. What happened? It was private public investment. Not a penny came to J&K. Not a penny came to J&K. You know, so in a sense that if you were to look, and government of India had no constraints in terms of acquiring land. They didn't face Article 370. How come that PSUs didn't invest in J&K?
Right.
You know, you can talk about private investment post-90s, because by 90, militancy had set in J&K, and why would a private corporate investment want to invest there? A, the overall situation is not very conducive. B, infrastructure is very, very poor. Forget 90. I can understand 90, because I, even as economic advisor of government, I led a lot of corporates to J&K. Nobody was interested. You have power shortages. Now you have internet issues. You have all kinds of stuff. The real question to be asked is, why didn't government of India invest through its CPSUs? There are 300 PSUs. And their total investments in the country are 25 lakh crores, which is 25 times the SDP of J&K. And they employ more than 1 million people as of March 31st, 2020, which is when the numbers came in. How much have they invested in J&K in the last 70 years? 150 crores. Out of 25 lakh crores, it is staggering. How much had invested in J&K? 150 crores. And out of a million people that CPSUs employ, how many are there from J&K? In J&K? 21.
Wow.
21. And as J&K Bank chairman, I have sanctioned loans worth 103 crores. Right? To locals. And what are we talking of here? We are talking of 25 lakh crores, even if, you know, and if there was a developmental issue, it rests with the government of India. Why did they not do that?
All right. I understand that point, Dr. Drabu. Let me ask you a slightly different question, which is, it is widely believed that the then Jammu and Kashmir state has been traditionally been highly subsidized by the government of India. Tens of thousands of crores were given to Jammu and Kashmir on an annual basis for its development. And that perhaps explains the argument that you earlier made, which is, you know, Jammu and Kashmir is doing much better than most other states as far as poverty is concerned, unemployment, or even for that matter, literacy. When you were finance minister in Jammu and Kashmir, in fact, you negotiated the PM development package of almost 80,000 crore rupees. So how do you sort of answer that sort of a public perception, as it were?
It's an important question, and I think it's good that you asked this. I want to make a distinction here between the government of J&K and the economy of J&K. Right. Okay, that's an important distinction to make.
Right.
The central government has been funding liberally the government of J&K, not the economy of J&K. So large amounts of money have come in terms of transfers from center to state, which happen in every state. So if you look at it from that perspective, J&K gets what is due in the constitution. You can't get outside the constitution. There is a laid out scheme, central state transfers. There's a share in taxes, which you will get as per the formula of work of the Finance Commission, which J&K got. Then you would get planned transfers, which have stopped now for all states, central state plans. You would get that. You would, J&K was a special category state, not in terms of 370, but by an executive order of Planning Commission. 10 of them were special category states. So they would get what is due to them. How would center give money outside of that scheme?
No special packages?
I'll come to packages also. There are only two packages in J&K which have ever happened. And I have had the privilege of heading both. One as economic advisor and one as finance minister. There's no third package. In fact, my argument with the government of India was this. Both times, as economic advisor first. And I remember Dr. Manmohan Singh was the prime minister since I had... Right. I knew him and I had worked with him. I walked up to him and said, sir, why are we doing this? Why can't you give me the same money? I'll do it as a package because it's getting into funding revenue deficits. And that nobody has a track. So I'm not going to ask for more money. I just want you to reorganize various things that are happening all around and we worked out a package. Interestingly, I asked for 6,000 crores and when it was announced in J&K, it had become 26,000 crores. And that is how it invariably works because some bureaucrat somewhere in finance ministry trying to look good added 18,000 crores of government of India equity into power projects which are not owned by J&K, which are owned by government of India and said
add that.
So I walked up to Sanjay Baru that time who was a friend of mine and I asked him, I said, Sanjay, did I hear, because the prime minister was speaking from the dais and I was sitting in the thing. So when I heard this 26,000 crores, I was like, what happened here? Because we didn't, you know. And then it turned out that it was like, you know, 18,000 crores. Now, when you look at it, you will see a number of 26,000 crores. Fact is, it was only 4,600 crores. 18,000 crores were absolute nonsense. They were like, you know, putting a thing. Now, the same thing, we negotiated a package of 80,000 crores. Now, while there were additionalities for it, but every single thing came from where you actually could get shares, like, you know, in Saraswati Abhiyan, you would get money. So you got a little more money than you would normally expect. So it's not as if it's a hugely subsidized. I think this comes from a historical baggage, which was very brilliantly handled by Sheikh Abdullah that time, who said, I'll not eat rice because rice is subsidized. I'll eat potatoes. I don't want subsidy from Government of India. It became a, it was a brilliant, brilliant political move. And it kind of, the whole subsidy culture came in from there. Yes,
can you explain the argument that you made a little earlier, which is one needs to make a distinction between the money that is given to Jammu and Kashmir government and the money that is given to Jammu and Kashmir economy?
Yeah. So what is happening is, for a variety of reasons, we can discuss that as well. There is a revenue deficit in the government's own budget, which really means interest, salaries, pensions. That's it. It has no developmental expenditure. They fund that. But they're not funding economic development. They are funding the employees of the government of J&K. You may want to know why does Kashmir have, J&K have 4.5 lakh employees and Bihar has only 4 lakh and Darbhanga district is bigger than Kashmir, right? Why that happened? That's a different story. It starts somewhere in 1953 when the first thing is done, when Sheikh Abdullah is sacked and all that, and Dubai. So it's like a layered form of corruption as a mode of cohesion. That you want to build, everybody stakes the system, you start liberalizing government employment and all.
Patronage.
There is enormous anecdotal evidence on how Bakshi Ghulam Ahmad would appoint people on their cigarette foils. You have the cigarette packets with those foils. He would write orders in that. It's a proper anecdotal history in Kashmir. So it starts with that. And you are funding the government, not the economy of J&K. Funding the investing in the economy of J&K is very different from funding a government budget.
The money that is given to Jammu and Kashmir for security expenses, where are they counted?
It comes under a category called security reimbursement expenditure.
Okay.
But there also, when you look at it in a little more granular manner, then it becomes a little more complicated. For instance, during floods, since I'm aware of this as finance minister, I can share this with you. I think Air Force had done some work for the government of J&K. Right. And all of a sudden, we were landed with a bill saying you have to pay them. So you are getting money from one quarter and giving to the other quarter, right? And we were not fighting a local battle. You're fighting a battle for the country, right? So it has to be a shared expenditure. So we found that killed us. No, but there were many other things. We took a lot of debt early on. Why? Because the 70-30 ratio didn't figure. The 90% grant, 10% loan wasn't applied to J&K. As an economist, as a policymaker, I have objected to it, saying I don't think we deserve that because we are a good state. We have good, our tax SDP ratios are very good. Right. They are comparable to Karnataka, which are the middle income better states. This despite the fact that we are an agrarian economy. So it's been taxed well. Our problem on the government side is expenditures, partly security, partly not managed well, whatever. So it is that funding that comes into your eye.
So if the fact that Jammu and Kashmir and its people have been doing well economically, educationally, etc., is not explained by the fact that they have been funded by the government of India, what explains that?
Massive, massive structural features, which nowhere in the world, I would say, which is, please realize that J&K was the first non-communist government in the world to introduce land reforms. Whereas the rest of the country is struggling with subsistence agriculture. As an unintended consequence of land reforms, we had commercial agriculture. Do you even realize? We keep talking about tourism and film industry. Do you even realize that India is the fifth largest producer of apples in the world? And Kashmir on its own is the sixth largest producer in the world.
Wow.
And if I had started something there, it was a massive program for replantation and high density orchards, which has come up a little, I don't know how it's gone now. I had submitted a note to the government of India, also published it subsequently, that if we follow this developmental paradigm, which is sustainable ecologically and otherwise, in 5 years' time, India would be the second largest producer of apples in the world. Second largest in the world. On basis of what? one thing, that is JNK. We refuse to look at these things. We have now decided to give some 35 industrial estates, some 10,000 canals. Now, tomorrow, you will not be able to figure out whether you are in a pet shop of Dharavi or you are in Kashmir, or you are in the old mill road of Bombay, because that kind of industry will come. I don't think that's what we want to do. The whole world is looking at an environmentally sustainable thing, and you have such an opportunity, such a market, such diversity of commercial agriculture. And you don't have to worry about income distribution like you have to worry about industrial development, because it has its own mechanisms of income distribution, right? You have a very good egalitarian asset distribution, right?
That's right.
If you look at, you have to look at some of the numbers. It is striking. The debt to asset ratio, which is done by the NSS, it is not done by J&K government. NSS has done it. They do it every year. The debt to asset ratio is the lowest in J&K, even better than Punjab.
That is interesting.
Because people have not, they don't need, because you don't realize, 1951, mein, 75% of debt was taken out. Debt tribunals were set off, 50% debt maaf, 50% whatever. So you created an enabling structure. This is precisely what in economic development, the hinterland problem had been addressed. It's a consequence of that. It's not a consequence of money that is going in. If there is one consequence of the government of India money coming in through various routes, it is a perverse income distribution, because only few people got access to it. Because of a system, whichever way. Plus, of course, when you look at the money that's coming into J&K in the budget, that is substantially lower than what actually comes in. A lot of unaccounted money comes from various sources. So you have created a situation there where there are grave economic problems, grave economic structural economic problems are there in the system, because, for instance, you have an asset price bubble. The land in J&K is as expensive as Bombay.
So Article 370 and 35A did not hamper economic development in Jammu and Kashmir. Will Jammu and Kashmir become a union territory? Will that actively hamper economic development in Jammu and Kashmir? Just reversing that question, that's all.
Of course it will. Because what is happening is you are now making policy remotely from New Delhi.
Right.
All economic policy evolves in relation to how your legislative structure is. Because you were an empowered legislator, you could do a number of things. Starting off with land reforms. No other Indian state could do, because it would violate the Constitution of India, Article 14, right to property as a fundamental right. That is why, in fact, that is one reason why 370 was put in, because you wanted to carry forward land reforms, which could not have been carried out under Indian Constitution.
That's right.
So when you have an empowered state, you can. My regret, to be honest with you, as a professional, is that we did not leverage 370 enough. We could have actually shown the rest of the country what could be done. One example, Industrial Development Regulation Act 1957. Huge constraint. It took the rest of the country some 30 years and Manmohan Singh to abolish it, apply to J&K. So you could have very well done what you wanted. So the legacy of a protectionist, controlled, command, Raj economy didn't exist in J&K. So I forever was arguing, why don't you make this J&K a model case and test out? For instance, we were trying to see Bombay should become the financial hub, right?
Right.
You could burn offshore banking and all. You still have not been able to do it. Why? Because there are 20 policies which prevent that. None of those apply to J&K. You could have very easily set up an offshore banking center in J&K without even bothering to do anything. So we never positively, I said this in the assembly also, I said my regret is that we have not leveraged 370. We have used it for political purposes, but not for developmental purposes. It could have been used. So it's certainly not a development dampener. If there's a fault, it was with the fact that nobody saw the potential of 370 to bring in those changes which rest of the country could not have brought it.
Right. Dr. Drabu, let me shift gears a bit. The PDP-BJP alliance that has been widely blamed for bringing BJP into Kashmir, where it did not have any existence at all. And this BJP then thereafter, of course, took away the special status and also the statehood of Jammu and Kashmir. You were one of the architects of the BJP-PDP alliance. You had negotiated the various policy plans with the BJP leaders, as it were. Looking back at the last few years and what happened last year in particular, do you regret the alliance that you put together with the BJP after the elections?
Let me first respond to this, that PDP brought in BJP. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's a one. And also a clarification that I certainly was not the architect, but I was the negotiator. Right. And it was a decision which was taken by the party. And I mean, I can put it on record here that it was a decision taken only by one man, which is Mufti Saab. And out of conviction, yeah. And for very good reasons. There'll be time on occasion to talk about that. But how it panned out is different. And not that he didn't realize that, but he was willing to take that risk. Because this is the only option he saw. And he did it in good faith, a lot of conviction, not a lot of compulsion. So having said that, so it's, he brought in BJP. Does anybody realize that in the 2014 election, BJP was the single largest party in Jammu and Kashmir in terms of vote percentage? No, in terms of vote percentages? It was better than PDP, it was better than NC. And when elections happened, there was no question of an alliance between BJP and PDP. So PDP came in, BJP came into J&K on its own merit in Jammu. That is a subset now. But PDP or Mufti Sayyid did not, or Haseeb Dravu did not bring in BJP into Jammu. They were the single, they had 23% vote share. PDP had only 20.
But PDP fought the elections in Kashmir on an anti-BJP plank.
No, why PDP? I fought the election on it. Every time I would go to my constituency, I would say that. Yes. But I would also say that this time around, please make sure that you vote one party. If you want to vote NC, please vote, but give them a majority. That didn't happen. So you were going, there was, and you can't build a certain thing based on what you had thought. It's an evolving situation. We went into the, as PDP, went into election. I don't know about the larger thing. I can speak for myself. I would go and campaign in my constituency about this. Absolutely right. I had only three issues. One was floods, one was BJP, one was apples. I fought my thing on, I had one slogan in my entire campaign. Ek kanal ka ek lakh, which was like the apple cutting, which is coming true now. Okay. So that's a fact. But situation evolved. We had 27 seats, they had 25 seats. And the real dilemma was, if you were to form a government without BJP, how will you run the state? Because you are negating the mandate of Jammu, which was very, very critical for governance purposes or ideologically for Mufti Saab, that I will not be able to run the state if I have nobody from Jammu. Did you also realize that Jammu Congress did not win a single seat? I mean, they didn't have the kind of where you could conceivably tie up with NC and with Congress, but that would not change the basic fact that Jammu would go unrepresented. And if you were to then get people from Jammu who were not elected, then you are violating the entire mandate or the logic of an election. So it was from that purpose. And also a very considered view of Mufti Saab that before I kind of reach out to Delhi, I must first reach out to Jammu. The gap between Jammu and Kashmir was very, very wide, and he was trying to bridge that. How it panned out is a separate thing. We can have separate explanations for that.
In 2014, Mr. Saeed and your former party PDP took a pragmatic decision to align with the BJP. Today, there are people in Kashmir, including some of your colleagues, Mr. Altaf Bukhari, who are making the argument that we should look for what is possible, we should look for what is achievable and be pragmatic about it. So Article 370 is gone. Why not ask for the return of statehood? What do you say to those people who believe in such pragmatic politics? Isn't pragmatic politics, something that works at the end of the day?
I would say to each his own, but learn from experience, number one. Number two, this is a different world. You're playing a politics of a very different era. Sheikh Abdullah could survive speaking of nationalism in Delhi, communalism in Kashmir, and communism in Jammu. But nobody knew about it because there was no internet.
That is true.
It is very famous about Sheikh Abdullah. He was the greatest nationalist in Delhi, the biggest communist in Kashmir, and the biggest communist in Jammu. Now, nobody knew this because there was no internet, right? Today, everybody knows the foregone conclusion that statehood has to happen. I mean, look, even though the bigger disappointment for me is that nobody has stood up for Kashmir when the federalism of India was put on a hanger and left out to dry, fact remains that you can't do this beyond 2 years, 3 years, right? So what are you asking for? It's a foregone conclusion. In fact, the home minister who converted the state into a union territory, at that point itself said at the right time and right over will be converted back to a state, right?
That's right.
So
that's
what
right.
are you asking for? You Making are trying to take credit for a development that may happen. Valid in 1950, 1960, 1970, not in 2020. People know it because the information download is so much that even before you and I know, they are available, you know, they are up on date on that. So I would just say that, you know, be a little more savvy and be a little more honest. I have no problem. They want to work with anybody. That's their prerogative. People will vote for them or not vote for them. Right? So that is their choice. But also let's not kind of degrade ourselves to this point that people don't understand. People do understand. So if they want to make a pragmatic decision, and what is pragmatic in Mufti's time may not be pragmatic now because something, a historical thing has happened in between. Things have changed. But they may find it still relevant. Yeah. I mean, did Sheikh Abdullah not support an RSS candidate in municipality in as early as 1953? 52? Did he not support them outside 1965 saying that, in Jammu? Why are we raising it today? And for what purpose? I mean, they have, you know, a proper presence in the valley now. They may not have had one seats, but in the state, they had 23% vote share, more than what PDP had. And what right does anyone have to kind of deny that? You don't want to vote for them?
Talking about your days of campaigning in Kashmir in 2014, you wrote recently that Kashmiri people don't see mainstream Kashmiri parties as having any role in the resolution of the Kashmir issue, as it were. What do you mean by that?
You know, when I was somebody who had kind of contributed to the whole self-rule document, and I was seen as somebody had access to Mufti Saab, and we were discussing, and you know, he had taken great pains to get me in and whatever. So I didn't expect that when I go campaigning, people ask me, you know, what is self-rule about? What is this? How? Nothing. So I'm wondering what is happening. You know, people would talk to me, and I was amazed by this, that people would talk to me in a remote village. I still remember. It was called Sukhpur. It's a small village in my constituency. And they would refer to some article I'd written in Greater Kashmir, saying, aapne ye kaha tha, usme what happened to that? But nobody ever raised this self-rule. Nobody ever raised autonomy. Nobody raised 370. There was kind of what is happening. Then you realize that they just feel that this is not your mandate. You are into governance within a framework, a glorified municipality, what we have become eventually. So, so they were really talking about, you know, those things that, you know, the big concerns in a village were generators, transformers for power, graveyard fencing, those kinds of developmental issues, local issues. So they had kind of said, you know, you guys are not into that. You're not even worth talking about it. But the whole sentiment, the ambience was very, very palpable. Which again, I've written that very palpable. That if you had to kind of go and campaign and you went to a house, you know, people would talk about that is ghar ka bacha militant hai. There was awe, there was respect. Yeah, of course. And they would determine whether the village would vote or not vote. What world are we living in? So, which is why I said in that piece that you referred to, that militancy had become a rite of passage, so to say. Because their social standing had improved. You know, social standing had improved. I remember, I know people whose children had died in this whole thing, how they were treated. Or those who were active militants that time, their kids, they would be treated differently. So, there was a certain sense of that, which is why I kind of said that they had decided that, and there's no confusion on that. You are into development, these guys are into resolution.
Here is my final question. I mean, there's a lot of talk in Delhi about Vikas or development, and one of the reasons why Article 370 and 35A have been removed is because New Delhi wants to usher in good governance and development in Jammu and Kashmir. Is it possible to have development in Kashmir without conflict resolution? Now, let me draw your attention to the Jammu and Kashmir's own economic survey, which estimated that protests and violence over a five-month period of July 2016 to November 2016 caused economic loss worth 16,000 crore rupees. The question that I'm trying to ask is, is it possible for New Delhi to build peace and resolve conflicts in Kashmir merely through economic empowerment, even if that is the what the intention is?
Two parts. That the economic survey you're referring to is something that I had done there and tried right. to figure out, you know, how do you, if you are, you know, shut for 360 days, I don't know how people survive. That's a very, very important question to answer. People haven't answered it. Ask a question. In terms of you know, economic development, I'm not sure if you know, there's only one condition required for Kashmir to prosper, which is peace. And it's a, it doesn't need an economist to tell you that. Mm-hmm. Investments are not political. They need an enabling environment of peace. After that is there, they need an enabling environment of infrastructure, which again,
that's right.
Is not there right now, hasn't been there for the last 30 years. Power is a big, big luxury. So you will not, no matter what you do. And the easiest thing for government of India to do is not to rely on private sector investments. In any case, for the next 3 years with COVID and all, I don't see anybody. There's no investment happening in the rest of the country. Where will it go to? Why will it go to Kashmir? The only option really is state-led development by the union through its CPSUs. That let us put some money and get some things into place. Even after you do that, suppose you were to do that and make a massive plan, most like exactly like what you'd done for the Asian Tigers. Right. You know, that whole state-led industrial development, Singapore, that kind of stuff. Take massive funds, bush it in or whatever. Will you kind of obviate the problem? No. You may lessen the intensity of the issue. You get people busier lives, it may build stakes into the system. That is true. That's long term. But it will not resolve the issue for you, no matter what you do. It is a political issue. It has huge social moorings, which is why I'm convinced of that we need to look at that. But the manifestation of it is very, very political. And unless it is addressed at that level, no amount of pump priming, subsidization, glorification, repression will solve it. It has to be handled in a much more thoughtful, careful manner. And some of it, though it's not work, some of it was done like that. You know, you are trying to build a narrative that that actually helps bridge the gap, which in this whole desire to play optics in politics has been lost. So a certain degree of political gravitas is needed if you want to go further down the right path in JLK.
Dr. Drab, wonderful talking to you. Thank you so much for coming on the show.
Pleasure. Thank you.
To receive instant updates on all videos from The Wire, click the subscribe button and hit the bell icon. Pay to support independent journalism. Click the link in the description and choose the amount you want to pay.